Welcome to, good morning and welcome to the induction program of the School of Management Studies. Today we have two sessions, that is from 11 to 11:45 and 12 to 12:45. In these two sessions, we will be taking you to a tour of School of Management Studies and its programs, more specifically management programs, because management program though it is a single program, but it a student can get into different combinations and they can get different diplomas and degrees. As we keep going in this particular session, you will be able to appreciate those things. Today we have along with me, I have Professor Khanna, who is our senior most faculty in the management discipline. He will be talking to you on the management program as such, and after that I will be talking to you on the MBA banking program, and if time permits we may even cover the project course. There is a project course in the MBA, so if time permits we will cover project course also. This is a very important these two programs are very important, because unless you understand the intricacies of the program, it will be difficult for you to sail through in future during the program, and you may keep getting lot of doubts about this program. So my request would be to please concentrate on this particular talk and try to discuss the issues. If at all you have doubts, please discuss those doubts at this point itself, so that you can sail smoothly. Now may I request Professor Khanna to make his presentation.
Thank you, Professor Ravi Shankar. Thank you very much. And welcome everybody to this program. As Professor Ravi Shankar is telling you, this program becomes very important for you, as because you are getting into the system through this program. You would like to know many things about the system and about the program. You see, all of you, those who have been admitted to this program, would have gone through the, we assume that you would have gone through the brochure or student handbook and prospectus which has come to you as part of application form. Application form was part of this brochure. We have very carefully designed this student handbook and prospectus, and it is our general experience that students normally do not go through the student handbook and prospectus very, very seriously. Therefore, they have a lot of questions asking for various petty things, various smaller things, and various, you know, simplest kind of things. Even to the extent we experience that those students who are in the system, say for 3-4 years or 5 years, still they keep on asking very, very basic questions, because the simple reason is that they have not gone through the prospectus very carefully. So if you go through the prospectus very carefully, perhaps 90 to 95% curiosity of yours will get resolved, because we have very, very carefully designed this document. On this document, we spent substantial time to keep you in mind, keeping the other person who doesn't know anything about the system in mind. So therefore, this document is very important for you. However, even though we expect you to have gone through this document, but still we would like to tell you whatever we think is very important for you to get into this system and the program. So welcome again to the School of Management from on behalf of all the faculty members of the School of Management. You see, management program got started in 1987. We started with the diploma called Diploma in Management. Then gradually we went on adding to these diplomas, and we offered MBA program in 1991. We offered with the minimum number of courses which were required for MBA program, but we kept on adding various courses to the program, and at this moment we have around 55 programs on offer, and out of which one is required to do 21 courses to complete the MBA. Now that you have been admitted to this program, you have various options before you. As Professor Ravi Shankar told you, that you have got into this program, but you have several exit points as well. So let us try and see that what this program is all about. What are the courses on offer? What are the diplomas on offer? As we are talking about several exit points, how you can perform? What is your capability, and what you can choose for yourself, and things like that. Now, if you see the screen, these are the programs which a School of Management, Faculty of Management in the School of Management is having on offer. We have a program on offer which is MBA, in which all of you have been admitted. We have a program MBA Banking and Finance, of which Professor Ravi Shankar is the coordinator. This is a very prestigious program and which is meant for a particular clientele group of bankers. This has been developed in association with Indian Institute of Banking and Finance. Of course, Professor Ravi Shankar will tell you more about this program. Now, DIM, PGDM, PGDIM, PGDHRM, PGDFM, PGDOM, PGDMM, these are the parts of modular parts of the MBA program which we have on offer. Like that's what we said, that you have several exit points. So a person who has got into the system can get out at any of these points. You may complete your DIM and get out of the system. You may complete your PGDIM and get out of the system as you wish. So therefore, we have a lot of flexibility in this system. Therefore, this system is known as open system. We have a lot of flexibility for admission, lot of flexibility in the process, but of course the exit points are being monitored very, very strictly. So therefore, not many people are able to complete the MBA program, and many people are getting exit points at the in the middle level. Now, basic features of management program, if we talk about, I told you briefly, that we have modular structure. What do we mean by modular structure? Is that there are several modules in the whole program, and one module add to the another module, and adding all those modules makes a total MBA management program. So there are four modules. DIM is one, diploma in management. PGDIM is another one, PG diploma in management. Then we have specialization diploma, PG diplomas in various specializations like HRM, marketing, operations and finance. And then we have five capstone courses, of which project is also a part. Project is one of the major components of this program, and which is equivalent to two courses. So therefore, as you know, you would have gone through the prospectus and you would have known that there are 21 courses to be completed for doing MBA, of which project is worth two courses. That means 19 theory courses and two courses worth a project. So therefore, 19 courses and a project will make an MBA. So there are different modules, as I told you, DIM, PGDIM, and then PG diplomas in various specializations. Semester system, we have two cycles of admission as well. As you know, you have been admitted by having appeared in the February test of Open Mat or last year's August test of Open Mat. So we have two cycles of admission, January and July. So those who appear in any of the Open Mat tests, in fact, if you pass the Open Mat test, you have the validity of entering into the system till ensuing two semesters. Like those who would have cleared Open Mat in August 2007 would also have got admitted into July session of 2008. So August 2007 Open Mat and February 2008 Open Mat, those who would have cleared, they would have got admitted into this cycle. We have semester system in terms of admission, and we have semester system in terms of evaluation also. So, term and examinations take place in the month of June and in the month of December. That means the end of first semester and end of second semester, or third semester and fourth semester, whatever the case may be. Now, we talk about single entry and multiple exits, as I have told you that this is a modular program structure. So, single entry is there. After having cleared the open mat test, then you have got entry into the arena, and now you have several options before you. You can go through a gate which will entitle you diploma in management. You can go, you can add on a few more courses, and then you can get a PG diploma in management, and then you can add on 5 more courses, and then you can get a PG diploma in a particular specialization which you choose, and so on and so forth. So there are single entry and multiple exits, but most of the people they get into the system to complete their management to MBA degree. Now we have another feature which is very unique. We have a feature which is called course wise registration, which is not there in many other programs of the university. Course wise registration is very important for those who want to get into the system to get exposure into a particular course or a few particular courses, because we also have the system of giving certifying even if you have completed one course from the university. So you will be certified for having completed one particular course. Say for example, this was started because we have been receiving many requests from many quarters that there are people who would not have time to complete the whole MBA, or else they do not even require to complete the whole MBA. Take for example a person who has done some degree, say engineering degree, say 25 years back or 30 years back, and the person is at a top management level in any of the industry or the corporate house. Now the person wants an exposure, because if you are at that level, you need an exposure to say many things, and finance becomes very important, HR becomes very important. So you may have got expertise elsewhere, but if you feel that you have no exposure in a particular specialization of this kind, say HR or say finance, so you may come into the systems to take up those 4-5 courses or 6-7 courses of that particular stream which you would like to get exposed to, and then you can get out of the system. So therefore a student is not required to complete the whole MBA if one gets into the system. So therefore this course wise registration is a great flexibility which has been provided, and registration remains valid for 4 semesters. We have this whole program is of 2.5 years. Whole program of MBA minimum duration is 2.5 years, but the maximum duration is 8 years. So within 8 years one has to complete all the courses. But suppose you have registered, say you have registered for say 2 courses, 3 courses, or 4 courses from this July 2008 session, those registrations will remain valid for next 4 semesters. That means this will remain valid till June 2010. If you are not able to complete any of these courses which have been registered from July 2008, if you are not able to complete by June 2010, then you have to re-register for those courses by paying the fee for that particular course. So therefore course wise registration is there, but there is a validity period for course wise registration as well. Now you have done registration for a few courses, now you are progressing in those courses, you want to do your assignments, and you want to appear into the term and examination, but you also need to plan for next semester as well. That means you have to plan for January semester, and this being a very big system, you need to be little more proactive and little more careful about the last dates. And all the last dates are provided in the student handbook, and you should go through those last dates. And there is a last date for re-registration as well. So if suppose you want to register for 3-4 courses in January 2009 session, so you have to go through the student handbook. Their re-registration form has been provided, or else re-registration form is also available at our study centers and region centers. You have to fill up those forms and then submit it by a particular date which is mentioned in the prospectus, and that date probably is 15th of September or 30th of September, whatever it is. So you should see that date, and by that date you have to submit that application along with the fee to your regional center. So that is what is known as re-registration. No wastage of effort. As I have told you that whatever you do, if you complete even a single course, then you will be certified for having completed that single course. Learning at your pace and place, and we have got around more than 300 study centers for management program all over the country. As this may not be out of place to mention here that we are also present in more than 30 countries abroad as well, but that is not of use to you. But we have around more than 300 study centers all over the country. So once you have been admitted, you would have been allotted a particular regional center and a particular study center which is nearest to you. So nearest to your place. You don't come to the university because it's open system. You need to only go to your study center for various purposes. You know, you have to go there for counseling. You have to go there for submitting the assignments. You have to go there for appearing into examination and so on and so forth. So it is quite nearer to your place, the nearest to your place, and at your pace as well. In fact, so if you are, all our students are busy executives. In fact, they may not be able to complete their program in the stipulated time period, minimum time period, which is 2.5 years. So therefore, we have kept a outside level also, outside limit as well, that is of 8 years. So if you are not able to complete in 2.5 years, you can complete in 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6, 7, or 8 years maximum. So learning at your place and pace is also one of the features of this program. Now, assignment is one of the very, very important component of our program. Assignment is essentially, put into the program to check your progress. It also compels you to go through the course material, because all our assignments are application-oriented assignments. Half of the assignment would be talking about the basic theory, whatever you have gone through, and rest of the assignment will be talking about your experience in whichever place you are working. So you have to go to that place, and then you have to find out, you have to do something, and then you have to submit in most of the courses. But in some of the courses it may be numerical oriented or case oriented or whatever. So most of the assignments are application oriented. Now evaluation, as I have told you, term examination takes place in the months of June and December. You have to submit your assignment. Assignments are to be submitted by 31st of March or 30th of April, whatever the case may be, and then you have to appear in the examination. Evaluation, assignments are having 30% weightage, and term examination is having 70% weightage. So accordingly, you have to see that how much rigor you have to put for which of the components. But passing in both the components is important, and getting an overall grade of C is also mandatory for you. So therefore, you have to see that percentage, you have to calculate the weightage, and then you have to see how much you have to score to get a passing mark. But if you study sincerely, if you attend your counseling sessions, you would be able to get better marks, because C only you should not be satisfied with. You should be always be aiming for B and A. Now there is a project course in the program, as Professor Ravishankar also told you, and I also told you, that this is one of the significant part of the whole program, and which is worth two courses. If the time permits, we will also talk to you about the project, even though you are right in the beginning, but there are other students who might be looking at this program, so they might get benefited by knowing about the project course. This induction program we have been organizing, and we organize at the beginning of each and every semester, so that new entrants, they know about the system, they come to know about various things which they otherwise may not be able to know by themselves. But as I told you, that all these things which we are talking about, they are written in the document which is called Student Handbook and Prospectus. Now we have the grading system. We do not have marking system as such. So there are 5 grades: A, B, C, D, and E. So as I've told you, that you have to secure a minimum grade to pass a particular course, and which is C. C is 50% and above. So therefore, you have to secure 50% marks to pass a particular course. Now these grades are, all these grades have been defined in the student handbook, so you should go through those grades. Now if I come to little more details about the structure of the program, You can see on your monitor, I am talking about diploma in management. As we have told you that no, this is a modular structure and there are several modules, and this is the very first module. Now there are different eligibility for diploma in management, and you would be knowing about the eligibility. Now I don't need to talk about the eligibility, because unless you were eligible, you would not have been admitted. But those who are not graduate degree holders, they cannot go beyond this diploma. Non bachelor degree holders can only go up to diploma in management level, and during this process, if you complete your bachelor degree, then only you will be allowed to go further. Now diploma in management, as we have told you, being the first module, this comprises of 5 courses. Now MS 1, 2 and 3 out of these 5 courses, they are compulsory ones. MS 1 is management functions and behavior, it's a basic management principles course. MS2 is a basic human resource management course, and MS3 is the business environment course. These 3 courses are compulsory, and out of MS4, 5, 6 and 7, 4 is accounting and finance, 5 is management of machines and materials, 6 is a marketing course, 7th is a MS7 is a computers course. So out of these 4 courses, one has to take 2 courses, so therefore it will make 1, 2, 3 plus 2 courses, that means 5 courses. Once you have completed these 5 courses, you will be automatically getting a diploma in management. If one wants to get out of this system after having got it, one is free to do that. But most of the people, they tend to continue and complete their MBA program. This is the very first module. So here 2 courses out of 4, 5, 6 and 7, they are left over. These 2 courses will be covered in the next diploma, which I am talking about, which is called PG Diploma in Management. Now PG Diploma in Management, you have done 5 courses. Now you have to do 6 more courses and complete 11 courses to get PG Diploma in Management. So out of these 2 courses are the leftover of MS 4, 5, 6, 7. Say for example, you had done MS 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 to get that diploma in management. So now you have to do MS 6, 7, 8, 9 and 8, 9, 10 and 11. So these 6 more courses added to those 5 courses will fetch you a PG diploma in management. these are the names of the courses which are there on your monitor. Now MS 7, 8, 9, 10 and 11. So 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 9, 10 and 11. These 6 courses in addition to 5 courses of diploma in management will fetch you a PG diploma in management. Now we come to the third module. Third module is various PG diplomas in various specializations. We are offering a specialization in 4 areas: human resource management, financial management, operations management and marketing management. Now these are the series of 2s, 4s, 5s and 6. So all those courses which are in human resource management, they will be starting from 21 to 28, 29 or whatever. Courses in finance area will start from 4, because MS4 is the basic course of finance. So courses in operations management will start from 5, that means 51, 52, so on and so forth, because MS5 is the basic course of operations management, and so is the case in marketing as well, because MS6 is the basic marketing course. So 61 onwards are the marketing courses. Now we have got 8 courses on offer in specialization diploma in human resource management. Now out of these 8 courses, one is required to take 5 courses, complete 5 courses, choose and complete 5 courses to get this PG diploma. We have got 8 courses, MS21 to 28. Out of these, 4 courses are in operation in behavioral area and 4 courses in the action areas. So out of these 8 courses, you have to choose according to your own background or choice or whatever, with the guidance of maybe your counselor or whomsoever. So you have to choose 5 courses and then complete those courses to get that PG diploma. Similarly, we have PG diploma in financial management. We have got 6 courses in PG diploma in financial management, and 41 to 46, and one has to take 5 courses out of PG diploma in financial management out of these 6 courses available, and then complete those courses to get a PG diploma in financial management. Same is the case with operations management as well. We have got 8 courses again in operations management area. One has to choose 5 courses out of these 8 courses to complete PG diploma in operations management. You would have seen in your student handbook that all the course outlines of all these courses have been provided in the student handbook and prospectus. So while choosing, you should first go through the course outlines there and see what interests you, what will benefit you, what is your background, what is your future requirement, and so on and so forth. So according to your own needs and choices, you should take up one of these four specialized and diploma courses. Now last one which we have on offer is in marketing management. In marketing management, we have got eight courses again on offer from 61 to 611. Now, this is again, you know, this will start from, we are in the process of completing 612 as well. And there are several courses which are in pipeline. So, out of these eight courses, one has to complete five courses. Now, these are the earlier ones which we are talking about, DIM, PGDIM and PGD. HRM, PGD, FM, PGD, OM and PGD, MM, all these are standalone diplomas, because having done all those, you will be certified to have completed a particular diploma or PG diploma, whatever the case may be. But now coming to, till now, if suppose one has completed all these earlier diplomas I am talking about, so five courses in DIM, six courses added to DIM, for PGDIM, that means 11 courses and 5 courses for any of the PG specialized diplomas. Now 16 courses have been completed by a particular student. Now other than 16, there are 5 courses are left over. Now this is the matrix which you can see for this is the offering which you can see for the last 5 courses. Out of these, 3 courses are compulsory. MS-91, which is an advanced strategic management course, is compulsory. MS-11 is also a strategic management course, and MS-91 is strong advanced strategic management course. MS-95 is compulsory, which is a research methodology course, because we have a feeling that and which is also very true, that unless you one knows about the research methodology, it is very difficult for a person to do the project. So it helps quite a lot in doing the project. So therefore this has been made compulsory. And MS-100, and which is worth equivalent to two courses. So these are the four courses which are compulsory. Now let me mention here that if one has to register for MS-100, one can register for MS-100, that means the project course, only after a student has registered for MS-1 to 11, that means 11 those courses, and MS-95, that means after having registered for those 12 courses only, you will be permitted to register for MS-100 course, because we feel that a person should have done all those basic courses and a course in research methodology, then only a person should take up project course. This we have done on the basis of the experience we have had for last more than two decades of the operations of this particular program. Now these four courses are compulsory. And now what about the fifth course? For fifth course, we have got five choices for you. MS-92 is these choices have been kept as per your background or your interest or whatever. So there is a course on public enterprises. If those who are working in public enterprises, they may take this course as the fifth course. There is one course on small and new and small enterprises. If they are entrepreneurs, they can take up this course. There is a course on technology management. There is a course on total quality management, and there is a course on international business. So these five courses do cater to the needs and requirements of various group of people who have been coming to us for doing the management program. Of course, we have not this would not cover 100% clientele which is coming to us, but this will cover a substantial percentage of the clientele which is coming to us. So this completes 21 courses to get an MBA for the student who will be completing them. Now this is the graphical representation of how our MBA program looks like. Now MS-1 to 11 one has done, and by having done MS-1 to 11, the student would have got two diplomas, that means the DIM and PGDIM. Now adding five courses from specialization stream adding to MS 1 to 11, one would be getting PG diploma in a particular specialization, and then MS 91 and 95 is compulsory, and one of those courses from four electives which are there, and a project course. All these taken together will fetch you a MBA degree from our university. Now, to deliver these programs, what is the approach of the university or the school? You see, we are the open distance learning system. There is a quasi, you know, permanent separation of students and teachers. You know, there are counseling sessions which are held at study centers regularly. There are 10 counseling sessions which have been proposed for each particular course. Each counseling session will be two and a half hours. So there are 25 hours which are supposed to be devoted through counseling session for the students at the study centers. But there are riders that unless there is a presence of so many students, the counseling sessions will not be held. Or else, if the first session will have so many students, then there will be rigorous counseling, or there will be continuous the other kinds of counseling sessions, or the counseling sessions will be reduced, and so on and so forth. So this is part of the system. But counseling sessions are there. Counseling sessions, we say that you should, and to the extent possible, you should attend all the counseling sessions, which are very useful for the students. Normally, we try and get good counselor from that particular area to go through the course material and remove your difficulties. There are different connotation of counseling session. If the time permits, perhaps Professor Ravi Shankar may dwell upon it, that what is how counseling session is different from teaching. But you will be benefited a lot if you go to the counseling session. Sometimes you may be busy, sometimes the distances, these may be the factors which may prohibit you for attending counseling sessions, but as far as possible, one should be attending the counseling session. Apart from, why do we call it multimedia approach? Because we are providing you self study material, which is called self instructional material. Now, that is also something which needs to be deliberated upon, that what is a self-instructional material. We build the teacher within the material itself, so you don't feel the need of, the absence of a teacher. So, teacher is built into the, basically this is the basic feature of self-instructional material. So, we are providing you study material, then we are having audio video programs in various courses which are listed in the student handbook and prospectus, where we have given the course contents, and there are counseling sessions which are held at study centers. There are these programs, audio video programs. Their video programs are aired on DD one channel 6:30 to 7 every day. Then we have got Gyan Darshan. We have got 6 channels of Gyan Darshan, out of which 1 channel is dedicated for teleconference. We have got IRC, interactive radio counseling programs, and so on and so forth. So therefore it is called multimedia approach, and we are not only sticking to the print material only. There are programs on Gyan Darshan, there are programs on EduSat also. Apart from teleconsulting, there are EduSat programs as well. IRC, I have told you, interactive radio counseling, which is held regularly by the faculty from the All India Radio channels. Then we have got emails, and emails of each and every school. There are emails, there is email for the School of Management as well. If you have any difficulty, you may write to us, but we may not be very prompt in answering your emails, because number of mails which we receive is very, 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 very large. Now, the helplines, if we talk about study center, is your nodal place where you need to keep in touch with, because study center is IGNU for you, for basic purposes, for practically all purposes. You need to contact your study center. That will be your contact point for IGNU. Study center you can use for counseling sessions. Study center, there is a library which is created at the study center. Of course, books are not being issued from the library to the students, because number of books are limited there, but you can go and consult the library. You can see and you can study the books over there in the library. We have kept some of the basic books which do broadly cover that particular course, a particular course in the library of most of the study centers. So there is a library at the study center. All the information about when the examinations are being held, what are the last dates, and how to go about doing anything. In fact, this is the center where you have to either send or go and deposit your assignments when you have done your assignments. And this is the center where from you will be coming to know that what are the grades you have got in your assignments, and also you can get the feedback about the assignments through the counselors who have evaluated your assignments. And all of that information, all of the details about the university will be available at the study center. So this becomes your nodal center. There is other center which is called regional center. You know, you are under a particular region, you have been attached to a particular center, your center falls under a particular region. For re-registration activity, you have to send your application to the regional center, and so on. I mean, there are different centers have been created for different purposes, but for most of the activities you are concerned with the study center. But if you are not getting anything, or if you want further information or whatever, then you can also contact your regional center. There is a regional director at the regional center. The whole lot of staff is there at the regional center. So regional center is another contact point for you. Now headquarters, of course, we are there. There are several divisions, and we have given you the names and the phone numbers of all those who are concerned with either say sending and receiving of study material, or about the SRE division, that means student registration and evaluation division. So anything regarding your registration, anything regarding your evaluation, anything regarding dispatch of study material, or anything else, we have provided you the names and the phone numbers of those who are responsible or who would be satisfying you on those queries in the student handbook. Of course, there are many students, so many times phones remain busy. We do get lot of calls for various things, but there are help. These are also one of the helplines. Many useful forms have been provided in the brochure. If you go through the brochure again, I will repeat that brochure is your greatest helpline. If you go through the brochure very, very carefully, your queries will be reduced, say by 90% or whatever. Those who are sending queries to us, they don't really go through the student handbook. And I assure you, and we are very, very sure about it, that if you go through it carefully, not many queries you will have in your mind. So therefore, please do that. And if you are still not satisfied, and if you want any other thing to be clarified or any more information, then you are also welcome to write to the faculty in the School of Management as well. And to whom to contact for what, we have said it has been provided in the student handbook. So these are the kind of helplines which are available for you. As far as your queries and your inquisitiveness is concerned, so you will be getting most of these information in the brochure. I would like to say so much. If you have any question, then we would be happy to answer that question. Meanwhile, I would request my colleague Professor Ravi Shankar to add to if I have left anything.
Thank you. Nothing more, but only thing is the role of the study center is most important for the students, because once they are admitted, they are attached to a particular study center, because the study center is the main point where they keep meeting every day, and they will be getting the counseling sessions, they will be getting the assignments, and whatever basic information they want about the university, that is the point. Even the examination center is the study centers most of the time. So study center has a major role in the whole teaching learning process of the university. Regional center, of course, it is there for other purposes and admission purposes, and if they have any difficulty, they can go to the regional center, that is there. But basic learning takes place at the study centers. So unless the students participate in good numbers, it will be difficult for the study center coordinator also to conduct the counseling sessions. So what I would suggest you is you participate to the counseling sessions in good numbers, then only he will be able to conduct the counseling sessions. Otherwise what will happen is, instead of 6 counseling sessions per course, they may reduce it to 2-3, and in an intensive form they may do the counseling, which may not be very helpful to you. It will be helpful to some extent, but not the complete help you are getting. So it is always better try to attend the study centers and try to attend to the counseling sessions, interact with the faculty. Luckily all our counselors are very good people and very knowledgeable people, and most of the time they encourage the students to come and discuss. Maybe there may be few exceptions, but in general I am talking. So let us try to use best, make use of the study center facilities to the maximum extent, because most of these are colleges. So what happens is, they also have their own libraries. In addition to our IGNU library, they have their own library also. So what happens is, that you can sometimes, with your good relations, you can use the college library also. So that, and these things are very useful for your assignment preparation and consulting the books and assignment preparations. Maybe Professor Khanna, we can talk about the evaluation system slightly. I think we have 2-3 minutes more time. So we have, I think, the 3-4 types of evaluation. So let us try to discuss that. Okay. Basically what we have is, if you open the study material, if you have got it by now, we have 2-3 types of evaluation systems, evaluation methodologies, evaluation schemes. What one evaluation this thing is, system is, we have built-in check in progress exercise, that is we call it as activities. After reading a particular section of the unit, you will be tested whether you have understood that concept or not through a evaluation exercise called activity. So we print a activity, under that activity we give 3-4 lines, blank lines. What we expect is, you will stop at that point of time and try to read that activity question and try to answer in your own mind, try to find the answer for that, so that you are sure that you have understood what you have studied so far. So that is one activity. And second activity is, at the end of the second evaluation exercise is the self-assessment questions we give at the end of the unit. These are covering the entire unit, and sometimes this is a kind of pattern of questions you would be getting in the examination. I don't say these are the questions only which are going to come in the examinations, but these are the models and guidelines for the study, for the examination also. So that is one way of assessing the student. And then we have the assignments, which is counted, the weightage, the 30% weightage is counted towards your final grade. And again we have the final term and examination, where 70% of the weightage is given. So both assignment and term and examination put together, your final grade is decided. You should have at least D grade in each component, but the overall grade should be at least C. Which, what I mean to say is, if you have got D grade in the assignment, if you have got a good grade like A in the term and examination, both put together can make a passing grade of C. So it is better you try for best grades, better grades, and get good marks and good overall grades, so that you will be able to use your degree for a better purposes. So I think with this we will break, and there is a 15 minutes break. So in the meantime, you can formulate your questions, and if you are ready, we will start the second session with answering your questions. Thank you.